everybody, and welcome back. God damn it.
It was a good try. It was a good try.
I've never stumbled out of the gate like that. I'm going to leave that in there. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Geek Tank Podcast. My name is Dave, and I'll be your host for tonight, and I am joined, as always, by my best friends, Josh and Kyle.
Hey.
Gentlemen, how have you been? I haven't really gotten to speak to you much for the past week because I've been a zombie. What have you been doing?
It's been a rough week.
What have you been playing?
Yeah, it's been it has been a week. I've been playing a lot of Dishonored 2, actually.
Oh,
dope.
Because that came out Thursday if you were a pre-order person like me, and then Friday for the rest of the world.
Must be nice.
I guess I I have put in I'm a little more than halfway through. I have put maybe 6 hours into it.
And you're playing as the daughter, right?
I'm playing as Corva. I actually started a Emily playthrough today for various reasons. I'm not stopping my other one. Work reasons.
Sure. Wink, wink.
Really. Work wink. Reasons. I like it. I will say that it is not as good as the first one. Like, at all. Just in terms of plot and level design. Although the fourth level, not design-wise, but technical-wise, like, just the way they animate and pull off the... It's like the environment kind of shifts and stuff. Very cool.
Is it like the clockwork
one? Yes.
Yeah, that looks super cool.
Like in that original trailer, like the announcement trailer, that did all that, that's actually in the game. And it looks like that. It's super cool. That level was cool for that, you know, for just seeing all that happen. But in terms of, like, the actual design of it, I'd say it was a little rough. Although, I was talking to someone else at work who's also playing as Corvo, and we were both like, this game is way harder than the first one.
Yeah.
It just feels way harder for some reason, even though I'm getting through levels where it's like, you were never caught and you didn't kill anyone. I still feel like I'm having a way harder time for some reason. Maybe it's just because I don't know like what to expect.
Yeah, so isn't that kind of the mark of a sequel, is kind of upping the difficulty a little bit? Usually?
I wouldn't say so, no.
I don't know. With games like that, I kind of expect them to, sort of.
I don't know. I mean, it's... I think a lot of it also does have to do with just the fact that, like, I've beat the original Dishonored like 4 times, so I kind of know the game at this point, you know? I don't really know this game at all, so it's like when I enter a room, I don't know what to expect.
Right.
Sometimes you open a door and you're like, holy shit, and you close it really quickly. Not really. Like, I don't know what... I didn't know that there was like 50 dogs back there. But I like it. The plot's... Like, it's it's like whatever.
The plot,
you know?
Is. The plot exists.
Yeah, the plot kind of just exists, unfortunately. I think if you were way into the the lore of Dishonored, I think that you will get a kick out of... They really expand on, like, all of it. They try to explain, like, the origin of the Stranger. They talk more about, like, the, you know, the Empress... They tell you more about Corvo. They tell you more about Emily. They tell you more about basically every character. And even more about, like, just the world that you exist in general. Because in the first game, it was just Dunwall. Like, they allude to the fact that there's, like, other nations outside of... Or, like, even other cities outside of Dunwall. But you never leave Dunwall in the first game. You actually go to other places in Dishonored 2.
That's cool.
Right.
Not
is Dunwall
like...
in it?
Yes. In the very beginning, and then I think at the very end. Yeah.
It's
so
like an insomnia sort of thing.
Yeah. But I mean, I like it. I don't think it's as good as the first one. I think the first one is just like everything it does is on point. You know, this one, it's like there's a couple of things like I don't like the intro. I think the intro for Dishonored 2 is really bad. It's incredibly quick. they try to, it's like, okay, it's been 15 years since the first game. Let's just like they almost just shove like so much information down your throat.
Oh, that's one of those.
Like in 2 minutes, like the intro was only like 2 minutes, and they're just like, ah, and
just like that.
In the first game, it's a good 10-15 minutes before, you know, like the, it's been long enough, before the Empress gets murdered in front of you. It's the it's like the whole point of the game, right?
Yeah.
So you get a good 10-15 minutes to kind of figure out, like, I'm this person. Like, I'm Corvo Atano. And then you meet, you know, Princess Emily. And then you get to meet, like, all the other people that are like, oh, you're back from your visit from wherever the fuck, you know, and all this stuff. And you get to walk around and kind of learn a little, oh, there's a plague and stuff. And all these things, like, they kind of set up, like, a little bit of the world before, like, they, you know, kicking into high gear. This game, it's just, like, it starts at 10. It's just like, here we go.
Right.
You know, and you're like, well, hang on. Like, I was talking to Nicole, because we're both playing it. We bought two copies of this game. And what was that? Oh, she just like waved up her arms like hallelujah. And
casting a spell, don't worry.
We both don't really like the intro. And we were both saying how it feels like there was probably a level before the intro that got cut. Like... Like, there was probably an intro level where maybe you played as Emily, like, running around rooftops and stuff and doing something, and then, like, Corvo catches you or something, and you have, like, a talk. And then...
Oh, I love
and
talks.
Then it goes into the intro, cause, like, maybe a couple days later or something. You know, to kind of give you some exposition, give you a little time to breathe and, like, get into the world. Because the intro reminds me a lot of the intro to Skyrim, which I think, while I love Skyrim a lot, I think that intro is another example of a really terrible intro to a game. Because it's like you're sitting in a cart and all they're doing is just saying like, oh, there's a civil war. Oh, these gods and all these people, all these nations, all these. Oh, you're this person. It's like they're just like shoving names and jargon just like down your throat for like 2 minutes before you even get to do anything, you know, and it does the same exact thing. And I think it was just funny since they're both Bethesda published games, but
interesting.
It does the same exact thing. Once the game actually gets started, though, I think it's awesome. It's more Dishonored. Someone asked me like, "Do I like Dishonored 1? Well, I like this," and I say, "Do you?" I'm gonna be like, "Well, it's kind of like, do you like pizza? Do you want some more pizza?" Like, that's kind of just what it's like. It's like, did you like Dishonored 1? Yeah? Well, then you should probably play this because it's just more of what you like, you know?
Right.
It's not going to be like, if you didn't like Dishonored 1, you're not going to like this one. Like, it's not going to change your mind in any way. It plays exactly the same. It relies on, like, a lot of the same mechanics. Like, sure, Emily has totally different powers, which are all pretty cool. And there's like a couple of different mechanics. Like, the first game had these things called bone charms, which were basically like passive abilities that you could find. They were like a collectible. And they have them in this game too, but they also have like a crafting mode where you can craft bone charms. But then they also have ones called corrupted bone charms, which actually make the game harder. So
they're kind of like talking about.
They're kind of like skulls in Halo. So
There you go. The analogy that works.
There we go.
Yeah. So basically, you know, they have ones that will like make the game actively harder if you want to do that, basically.
They're like modifiers?
They're modifiers, yeah. So like you'll have one that's like you take less fall damage, or you're more likely to find money on guards or something. It's stuff like that, basically. They're like perks, and you can swap them out like freely, basically. But you have to find them. They're like collectibles in the world.
I have now one important question.
They have the regular ones, but they also have these corrupted ones that make the game harder. That'll be like, your footsteps are louder or something. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's kind of cool. It's not something I'm going to mess with, but, you know, those weirdos on YouTube will probably mess with, and that's cool for them.
Those weirdos.
Yeah, like those. There's some crazy playthroughs of Dishonored 1 on YouTube. Like people with just these like really crazy orchestrated kill streaks.
PewDiePie.
I watched one today where a guy looks into the air, fires an arrow, then goes and kills like five people, and then puts its telescope on and looks off in the distance, and then the arrow like hits this dude in the head. Like he arced it, went and killed like five people, and then looked at a different guy, and that arrow went and got him. I was like, what the fuck? It's crazy. Yeah, I mean, if you didn't like the first one, you're not going to like this one. So, but if you really like Dishonored 1 like I do, you'll probably like this one, even if it's definitely not as good as like tight as the first one was. I think.
Is it a GOTY contender?
Some people have said it is, and I think just based on like how good the first one is, I would say sure, but like it's not my game of the year. I mean, which is weird to say because Dishonored 1, when that came out, was my game of the year, and it's still one of my favorite games.
Right.
Probably like top 50 for sure. But like this one, definitely, I'm like, no, I don't think it's game of the year. I mean, there's not much like bad I can say about it because I'm having fun playing it, and I'm enjoying it because it's like I said, it's just more pizza. But it's kind of like oh, it's disappointing to me because I'm like, oh, it's just more pizza. You know what I mean?
I guess.
And it's not as good. Like it's not as like fresh as it was. Like
none of that buffalo drizzle. Cooled off a little chicken bit.
The cheese is starting to re-solidify. You're like, eh.
There's not enough bacon on it.
Yeah.
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 But it's, it's like the bacon's there, but it's like, but it's just like you're
starting
just
to harden.
Yeah, I guess a little bit. Yeah, the crust is passable, but it's not like that amazing crust that like you just take your time eating really, really slowly.
Yeah. But I mean, I am really enjoying it. If I had to relate it to a cookie somehow, I'm not gonna do that. But yeah, if you like Dishonored 1. I highly recommend playing it because it's just more of what you like. And if you didn't like Dishonored 1 and you're curious, I mean, I don't really know that you're going to change your mind now. Like, there's not really anything here that's going to make you change your mind. So.
Okay, then.
That's about it. It's mainly been Dishonored.
Gotcha.
Dishonored.
Well, that used up about a good 15 minutes. So
sorry. It's a new release. You know,
Josh is excited.
I know. I understand you're excited, Josh, but we're going to have to forgo me and Kyle on this case because we got to get through the rest of the podcast. Ladies and gentlemen, we are the Geek Tank Podcast, a show where we dive right into the trenches of the gaming industry and give you our brutally honest opinions. You can find us on YouTube, iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, and every other platform every single week. If you enjoy listening to this, please make sure to leave us a like or a favorite. Just let us know that you enjoy our show, because whether it's your first or your 24th, I got it, listening in, you're an honorary member of the battalion. And with that, we'll move on to This Week in Gaming.
Popping it up out, magic's in the air.
Whoa. Where was that going?
I might actually put that in instead of the actual bump.
that was that episode of Always Sunny where they do the beauty pageant for the little kids, and that's how Charlie like comes out to do the musical intro. He's like, "Scoot a bop, bop, it up, damn it, all magic's in the air."
I love that you know all these fucking It's Always Sunny references.
Dude,
off the
it's
top of your head.
Always Sunny is my Seinfeld. Like, I've seen it a million times.
It's a 10 out of 10 show.
Oh, it's so good.
Never seen an episode.
Oh my god, Dave!
This must be corrected
at
some point.
You are truly missing out.
You know what's funny
is
that like I'm actually geographically closer to Philly than either of you.
That is true.
I know.
Yeah. Like I'm literally
they have the Philly Fanatic on there.
I'm a car drive away from Philly. Like it's about two or three hours.
The Philly Fanatic. But we can't say it.
I could theoretically, if I was driving fast enough, like if I'm going like 90, 100, I could probably get down to Philly if I left this podcast right now. And drove, I would still get there before midnight.
Seriously,
so,
Dave.
Go
watch it.
Watch
like
it.
You'll love it. It's totally
it's,
up your
it's
alley.
It's so good.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna make it's mental note on top of everything
else.
It's
truly funny shows on TV anymore.
If I can make time to binge watch something, I definitely will check it
out.
Oh,
you don't need to binge watch it. I mean, there's a lot of it. So,
was it 11 seasons now?
I think they just did 12.
My God.
Yeah. And they're like, they got renewed for like three more or something.
Yeah, damn.
So. It's still going. Yeah. It's so good,
anyway,
though.
We're going to move on to the first piece of news for tonight. Xbox and Halo came out exactly 15 years ago today.
Oh my god.
So Microsoft has actually published some statistics, and this is just for from Xbox in general, not Halo, but this is from the first 15 years of Xbox, basically just a bunch of totals, essentially. The number of players who have played on Xbox, 222,468,423. The number of total gaming hours, 100,539,390,670. The total of multiplayer hours, 29,304,183.
29 billion? That seems really low.
It's still
Josh.
Well, Josh, like the total number of gaming hours in general was 100 billion. So the total
of
multiplayer hours.
Oh, I thought
hours...
you said total number of well, yeah, but total number of online hours is only 29 billion. Well, I'm like, over the 15 years, that seems kind of low. I would have expected like
you have to
cracking trillion.
You have to factor in that during the original Xbox era, like not everybody had Xbox Live. It wasn't like the mainstay it was for 360. So a lot of people were playing just like local co-op and like, you know, single player like I was. I didn't have Xbox Live. So I can see that.
You're making some valid points here.
But anyway, I'm going to get through the list here. Number of achievements unlocked, 32,667,582,157. damn, that was a sneeze from Nicole right there.
The classic Nicole sneeze. Staple around these parts.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think I need to read. Actually, the other one I will say, the highest gamer score was 1,416,465. To compare that, I'm going to check my gamer score right now. My gamer score is... Come on. Load up computer. Save my gamer score. Come on. Come on. 16,650. So that's the difference, ladies and gentlemen. And lastly, the number of Xbox Live friendships made, 4,233,891,482.
I was like, wow, a lot of people have no friends.
But no, it's so we also get some, we get an image from Seamus Blackley. I'm not sure who Xbox designer. Okay, he was the Xbox designer. He shared the picture of that that original X that we saw when they first revealed it, where it was like that silver X with the green circle on it, and people thought that was going to be the console.
Oh, the concept.
They
were just like
Xbox.
They were like, guys, this is just the concept. Relax, you're not going to be carrying this heavy piece of crap around.
Yeah. But, it was also super ugly.
Yeah.
I mean, like, it was... that looked like a Windows icon, like for a program, is what it looked like.
Exactly. So, with that being said,
this is it.
Xbox and Halo, because Halo did launch with the Xbox, are now 15 years old. They are a high schooler, ladies and gentlemen.
That's pretty crazy to think about.
And to put it into perspective, we were all in middle school when that thing came out. I mean, actually, I was
in elementary school.
I was fifth grade. I remember now. Yeah.
Yeah, I was a fourth grader.
But, man.
So, I remember, I don't know if you guys remember this, but, like, when I was younger and, like, Mega Man hit its 15th anniversary and Sonic did and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, those emblems would come on those games, and I remember thinking, like, oh, whoa, that's, like, a really old franchise. And now to see, like, those things, which started out on, like, the NES and the SNES and stuff, now to see the Xbox be that old, and, like, that was what I grew up with.
Halo,
like, it's
sort of old?
You know, yeah, like... it's weird. It's sobering in a weird way.
Although, honestly, Josh, I think we've been slowly coming to terms with that with our Let's Play of Halo anyway.
Oh, yeah.
Just like, wow.
You guys bash on that game too much.
Rightfully so.
We're, like, really tired when we do them, and it doesn't help at all. We're like, oh, God.
I think that game stands holds up pretty well.
I still enjoy it. Don't misunderstand
me. The jumping in Halo 1 is freaking terrible.
It's just different.
No, it's bad. It's bad.
It's not that bad. I go back and play Halo 1 quite a bit. I did probably maybe a couple of weeks ago. I played a couple of
so
levels.
Do we.
Yes.
Obviously, yes. I'm just saying that I think it's a little bit of a hyperbole. It's
I agree with you on that.
From
one,
my
Kyle.
Point of view.
Y'all I mean, want like, some of this hyperbole?
I mean, my Woo! Argument my argument about Halo is that there are parts of it that haven't aged well, but I still enjoy playing it. Like, I can still pick it up and still enjoy it, but, like, I was talking to Josh about this. I think that was during the library level I was talking about it, or it might have been the last episode we did for the two betrayals, where as you get further and further into the game, you start getting a lot more random death. Like, literally, you'll just be walking around, all of a sudden you hear that plasma grenade going off, and then you're just dead. Like, you didn't see it, you don't know where it came from, you're just dead. You know.
I mean, another thing I want to add on to that, just... Yeah. From an outside perspective, is like when I go back and play Halo, it's a stern reminder that games were very, way different, and that like if you go and play a Halo game today, you will not die very often. But if you go back and play earlier Halo games, I die quite a bit. Especially like I've been playing Halo 2 infrequently, but I've been like short of in spurts where I can been playing through the Master Chief Collection version because I actually like that remaster.
Yeah,
and it's yeah, I die way more frequently than I would have thought I would have, and then I play a game like Halo 4 and I literally beat that in like a few days without even trying. So right. I think it's just a different way that they designed stuff back then.
Well, but... I'll agree with you to a degree when it comes to Halo 2. I think Halo 2 is like the quote-unquote good difficulty where it lets a gamer be good, essentially, whereas Halo 1 I think nowadays has a lot of that stuff that's just cheap. Like I said, like
I mean, yeah, I agree.
There's stuff that
I
just
most
goes
of
off and you don't see it coming.
I think most of that's just, yeah, difficult splash damage that does more damage to your health in general.
Yeah.
So the balancing's a little off skewed.
Whereas I believe Halo 2 is a little bit more balanced. And, you know, if you're going to die, you die fairly. Like, it's like, you know, because you fucked up, not because, you know, because a grenade explosion from way on the back of the map hurled a grunt at you that had a plasma grenade. So that exploded and killed you. Like
I think
I'm just like, are you fucking kidding me?
I think games back then just demanded you had more patience than games today.
That's a little bit true, yeah.
That too.
Because games today, they're like, we have to get you in. They're very much like, you know, editing a video. It's like first 4 seconds, if something's not happening, like people just leave, you know?
Right.
So like,
yeah.
Games now are very much like big explosions, big hooks, like right off the bat to get you in, as opposed to like letting you seep in for an hour. Because then people will be like, this is boring, they'll just go somewhere else. And also, like, just frustrating people. You know, you go back to those old RPGs, and they just don't tell you. It's like, oh, that random NPC in that one town that you don't really know. Like, that's who you're supposed to talk to. And then, you know, in games today, it's, like, made really abundantly clear, like, who you're supposed to talk to. So,
yeah, and then also back then, those games had... That was, like, I call that, like, the strategy guide era. Basically, like, for those that really wanted to, you know, really wanted to beat the game and just were not good at paying attention like me, you bought a strategy guide. I did for a couple games, actually.
I had quite a few back in the day.
Yeah, me too. I had the Soul Reaver strategy guide.
Wow.
Soul Reaver. Yeah.
And
can we talk about Xbox for a minute, too? Because, like, damn.
Yeah.
That's a console that, like, I know isn't really looked back upon very greatly, especially in hindsight, but... Jesus, man, I fucking love the original Xbox. I love how big it is. I love the Duke. Yeah. I just love how bulky it is.
I also share your love of the Duke.
It's just such a great fucking controller.
It really is. I mean, it's made for adults. That's the problem.
That
when
is
I was
so
a
true.
Kid, I hated it because I was a kid.
I didn't understand why it felt like the way it did. But man, when I grab it now and it just fits perfectly and like that D-pad is like curved and it just feels so smooth to play on and like, oh God, I've been going back recently because my brother gave me our original Xbox and I plugged in what did I play? I played a little bit of Soul Calibur 2, which is probably like,
oh my God,
I wouldn't
Soul
say the
Calibur
worst
2
version,
Xbox?
But, oh, yeah, with Spawn.
I have HD now and I love it, but
it's pretty great. Yeah. HD on like the re-release and stuff, but God, I've been playing some of that. I've been playing like a few guilty pleasures I have, like NBA Inside Drive, which I recently rebought, like a game that nobody cares about.
Yeah.
Amped Snowboarding,
you
which
were talking
I,
about
I
Amped,
still
yeah.
say is a solid snowboarding game. I love Amped. I actually played Battlefront 2, Dave. I went
oh,
back
nice.
To that. Yeah,
my dude.
And then immediately realized
Xbox.
Like this has been too long since I played this game.
I mean, I have like a lot of like I guess like multi-plat nostalgia for Xbox as well for some reason. I guess it's because you guys all know my Christmas story about the GameCube, but I got the Xbox right after that. It was like a year after. And so that was the game, that was the console I was getting the multiplats on for whatever reason, even though they were on GameCube too. But like, I have memories of playing like The Simpsons Hit and Run on Xbox. I have memories of playing DDR on Xbox.
The worst ones.
Well, actually, I liked Ultramix. Ultramix had like Max 300 and all that stuff. You know,
that's true. Yeah, it did have some like the staples, but
it was missing the best one. It was missing the best one, Breakdown, though. So, a Breakdown. Sorry. I played that, by the way. I played DDR about a month ago and it almost killed me. Because I'm so
Like
fat.
Physical DDR?
Yeah, because I'm like so fat and out of shape. Like, I was like, yeah, I'm going to go on.
It's tough to play, especially after a long time.
I feel you, man. I rode a scooter like a week ago and I was like, Jesus Christ. I can't do this activity.
Fuck you.
Oh man, if there's anything that reminds of how old we are, it's talking about shit like this. But
did anybody have original Xbox Live? I had it.
I didn't.
I didn't have Xbox Live until I actually didn't have an original Xbox. I played it at a friend's house because my parents were very like, you can only have one console. And it wasn't until I got a job when I was like, F you, mom and dad, and I bought a PS3. But yeah.
Yeah, my parents were that way too, so they bought my original Xbox for me and were like, okay, this is the last console we're ever going to buy you. And then, of course, like, I conned my dad, not conned, but, like, begged my dad to use fucking, what did he use? He used, like, my student loan money. It was so fucking insane. But the original Xbox, I remember so vividly. Like, it had that really weird headset, do you guys remember, that would come in the box when you got Xbox Live?
I saw those headsets. I never played, I never used them.
Yeah, no. it was like this one wire that you would bend around your head, and like, it took me so long to get used to it because I thought that I would have to bend it around my head like normal headphones, but it goes like around the back, and that's just me being stupid. But man, I remember because Halo 2 would come with like those 2 month sort of preview Xbox Live passes, right?
Yeah,
and that still happened on 360 to an extent, but they would do it like for 2 days instead of a month or whatever. And
well,
so
they used to give you a little more, but yeah, they started like around the 360s being like, nah, you're not getting any now.
Exactly. Yeah. So whenever I had it on the original Xbox, I hooked it up and then I would use those preview codes that we got or whatever. And then I would play for like a month or whatever. And that changed my whole outlook on gaming. Like playing Halo 2 online with that, and then eventually getting my own official Xbox Live account, that just like changed my entire life. I feel like if I didn't have that in that moment, I don't know if I would still really be playing games like I do today. And Jesus, like, I had so much fun with Halo 2 and then eventually Halo 3, and then somehow my online multiplayer like just obsession died almost immediately after that, because then I got more invested in the single player games. But
gotcha. Yeah.
Oh, I've got a ton of memories with like Unreal Championship.
Oh yeah,
Fable,
Unreal
of
Championship,
course.
Fable. Now there is one thing I want to do, real quick, and I think this would be a fun little game, mostly just to test our memories and also if these games have any lingering nostalgia. I'm gonna go through the launch titles that came out with the Microsoft Xbox, and we'll see which ones we remember, and you know if they were even any good. So in alphabetical order,
most of them are bad, by the way.
Yeah, so just full disclosure, most of them suck.
Yeah.
The first one in alphabetical order, 4x4 Evo 2. It looks like a off-roading game. It has a Jeep Wrangler on the front of it.
Is that an Evangelion game?
It's made by Terminal Reality.
What's in my head is a 360 game, so I'm not thinking of a game.
Terminal Reality. They may connect Star Wars. How about that?
No shit.
They ain't no hologram, girl.
Anyway, moving on.
Oh, God.
The next game, Air Force Delta Storm. I remember Air Force Delta from Dreamcast. I did not play Air Force Delta Storm, though.
I don't know this one. I thought I'd know more of these. Wow. Yeah, I don't know.
I knew the game. I never played it, but I did play Air Force Delta, which was fantastic. Anyway, moving on. Arctic Thunder. Developed by Midway
Arctic
Games.
Great.
Sounds familiar. Oh man, Midway, those guys aren't around anymore.
Here's one I'm hoping you guys remember, because I certainly remember it. Cell Damage.
Yep.
Yeah, I know Cell Damage.
Basically,
dude, I remember one of the random videos from that game. It was like this fat trucker guy, and he would yell, "I'm BLT without the lettuce."
What the fuck?
I just remember I played.
I don't know why I remember that. It's so dumb.
It's like a Twisted Metal, but cel-shaded.
But cel-shaded,
and stuff.
I actually have it on I have it on Vita and PS4 as the HD.
It's a pretty good game.
It's a great game.
Yeah, it's not bad. It's
bad.
Fun.
Yeah.
But okay, moving on. So this one I don't remember. Dark Summit. Looks like a.
Why does that sound so familiar?
It looks like a. It's a snowboarding game. Oh, this is actually the Wikipedia page is empty. It just says Dark Summit is a 2001 sports video game released by Radical Entertainment. The game simulates snowboarding. And that's all it says.
You know, I've never played this game, but I know exactly what this is.
Yeah.
Because I think it was tied to like, it was action based, but I think there were like hazards on the mountain and stuff you'd have to avoid.
Yeah. I don't remember.
Yeah, I know this one. I think.
Okay, so now we're going to go through a trilogy of games you have to remember. So, Dead or Alive 3.
Of course.
Yeah, you have to remember
Dead or Alive 3. I asked my dad so many times for Dead or Alive 3. He never got it for me, so I had to wait till DLC.
Gee, I wonder why.
Well, that's the thing. He couldn't tell. So, like, I showed him the trailer, and the trailer doesn't have any of that. It's just, like, June fighting somebody.
It's also called Dead or Alive. I mean...
He wasn't that bad about it. He got me fucking Halo, so...
Yeah, my mom, she sees Dead... blood, anything like that. Like I was telling you guys the story of her trying to get the game Bloody Roar. Did I ever tell you about that?
Oh yeah. I do remember you.
She was like, "You're not having none of this shit."
Yeah, it took. I didn't get Halo till I was 13. Anyway, Halo came out when I was 10. Anyway, moving on. Here's the greatest game that ever came out for Xbox, and I'm going to simulate the announcer for this game. Fusion Frenzy! Yeah.
Dude, Fusion Frenzy's great, man. Yeah. What a fucking party game. It really bums me out that series didn't kick off.
There was a Fusion Frenzy 2 for Xbox 360.
And it was really bad.
From what I understand, I never played it. But I just love that whenever you open the game, it's time for Fusion Frenzy!
That fucking little robot referee, dude. Oh, man.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Such good memories. I played that game quite a bit. Anyway, here's a game no one's fucking heard of. Halo Combat Evolved. Okay, moving on.
Yeah, never heard of that.
Okay.
That old chestnut.
Next one, Mad Dash Racing.
Have not heard of this.
Developed by Crystal Dynamics, actually.
No shit.
Publisher Eidos. It looks like it's a racing game, but they're on foot, and one's like a warthog, and the other one's...
Is this Sonic R?
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
Super Sonic.
I think this
racing.
Was like Xbox trying to like, you know, have these like full encompassing amount of like kind of games, like, you know, have your shooter, have your goofy games, have your cartoony games.
And you gotta have a strong lineup.
Yeah. So the next one, we'll just skip over.
Oh,
what?
Come on.
Yeah, what?
You said have your shooter, have your racing game, and I said and eat it too.
Oh God, shut up. We waited that long for that joke.
I stopped myself for that. All right, whatever.
Fuck you guys.
What's the next game?
Madden NFL 2002.
Yeah, I saw this demo. All I have in my head is like that theme song of like da 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 da.
I don't
watch that trailer so many times.
I don't really remember Madden from that. I mean, I remember the same way I remember any Madden game. It's kind of just like whatever.
But, wait, no, I'm not thinking of Madden. I'm thinking of NFL Fever.
That's different. Yeah, the NFL Fever wasn't a release.
That was the Microsoft one.
The other ones are two NASCAR games, NASCAR Heat and NASCAR Thunder 2002.
Is that like a Pokemon thing?
Yeah.
Pokemon.
Yeah, whatever. Actually, Kyle, I'm sorry. I misspoke. NFL Fever 2002 actually did come out as a release title. It was actually a launch title.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And there you go.
So,
but you were talking about Madden then, though, right?
Yeah, the first one I was talking about.
So still, I was wrong, but yeah.
Was this back when EA refused to put their games on Xbox because of the whole server thing?
What?
You don't remember that? Like, the EA sports games were not on the original Xbox for, like, a good year or two because EA wanted them to use their own servers for online
Xbox
play,
Live?
And Microsoft refused, so they had to make their own sports games for, like, a year or two.
Interesting.
You didn't know that?
I know that they had made their own sports games for a while, but I didn't know.
That was the reason.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Interesting.
Yeah. All right,
and then I think we also have another one that was kind of like a third-party sports game, too. NHL Hits 2002. Which
I remember that. Was that the one where you could hit people?
Yeah, but looking at this game cover, this is a really cool-looking game cover. I really like how this, like, just the aesthetic of this.
For those who are listening, it's just, I don't know who the fuck this hockey dude is, but it has the logo on the bottom, and there's like a flash behind it, and there's lightning in the background.
Yeah, oh, it looks cool. And it's also got the.
It feels like that.
It's got the Jersey
period,
Devils
sure.
on there, so I'm cool.
Okay, New Jersey Devils, yeah. I don't know hockey, so.
I don't know hockey either. I just know my team. But,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, all I know are the Blues.
Moving on. Oddworld Bunches Odyssey.
Fuck yeah. Oddworld, that's the one with the soda can.
That's
the
soda
cover.
Cans, yeah. I remember
it's all about
where did I play
merchandise
this?
And shit.
I played the HD version of this. I don't remember where I did. Where? Like maybe it was like
HD?
A, Maybe.
Well, oh yeah, that got re-released recently, right?
Yeah, it might have been on PS3. I played it.
I think.
I don't know. I think no, they put it out for the PSN games during on PS3.
Yeah, I think
that's
you're
what
right.
happened. Yeah, I was like, definitely play this. Like, I don't like, and I didn't play it on Xbox, mostly because I had heard that people weren't so hot on it when it came out. So I was just like,
I was a kid, so I didn't really know, but I did play it at a friend's house, and that was like my most introduction to it. Like, I remember seeing other people talk about Oddworld and like being reverent for like the original couple of games, and I had no idea that they existed. So I was like, oh, I didn't know everybody liked that Munch's World Odyssey game. It's like, no, you have no idea.
Wow. Okay.
I was a dumb kid.
Next game. Actually, this game kicked off quite a series for a while. Project Gotham Racing.
Yep.
Hell yeah, dude. PGR is amazing. Man, fucking Bizarre Creations. Rest in peace.
Yeah,
what a studio.
What happened to them?
They made Blur and it didn't sell enough.
They went out of business.
So yeah, EA sold them off.
I didn't know.
Because they made Project Gotham Racing 4, and I believe their last game was Geometry Wars 2. And then Electronic Arts bought them, so they made
Blur
on the Electronic
game.
Arts.
Geometry Wars 2, man.
Fuck,
I was obsessed
dude,
with that.
I
for
love
a while.
Every single from PGR 1 all the way to the end of the line, because Blur is a really good kart racer with like actual cars. It's so good, man. I remember playing that game a lot. But
looks like they got to PGR 4 before they stopped.
I know. I really miss PGR 2.
And they have,
I think,
the club.
Obviously.
As well.
Yeah, obviously Forza is a much better sim game, and PGR was sort of emulating the earlier Gran Turismo games, which is obviously why Microsoft wanted to pick it up. But I think there was a predecessor to PGR. I don't remember what it was called. It was something like Metropolis. It came out on the PlayStation, and that was very Gran Turismo like. So, but yeah, man, those are good games.
Oh, interesting. Well, good to know. Next game up on the list is Shrek.
Dude, I had this game.
Shrek,
I had
this game.
Oh, man. This is a bad, bad video game that I have a lot of.
I'm looking at the reception. It said, like, average 52%, which is, like...
Yeah, it's garbage, man. It has nothing to do with the movie, pretty much. It's just, like, you are Shrek. There are... Oh, God, who's the bad guy?
There are many Shreks.
Oh, God, man.
And you must battle them for dominance.
All you do is you sing into a microphone and you just see somebody wants to win the world. Gonna run me.
So I hate the sharpest tool in the shed. Achievement unlocked.
I remember seeing like the screenshots of it and I was like, if I ever get an Xbox, just fuck no.
Dude, I remember the commercials for it. I remember seeing tons of Shrek commercials for the Xbox game.
Yeah. It is also difficult as hell. Like, I remember. Because when my parents got the Xbox for me and my brother's 6 years older than me, so they wanted to get him games that he would like, which I liked as well. So they got like Tony Hawk and Amped and stuff for him. And then for me, they were like, here, you can have Shrek. And like, I haven't even seen this movie. I'm in fourth grade. And I'm just like, I'm not a fucking baby, mom and dad.
You have to assume, if you're a parent, you have to assume that like, if you have two boys and one of them's older, like anything the older brother likes, the little brother is automatically going
to listening to Misfits in third grade, guys.
Wow. Yeah, you don't even.
I can handle Beyond Shrek.
Wearing your little punk jacket with all the patches.
Jumping up on his desk, screaming, "I turned into a Martian."
I go where he goes there.
Yeah, but I'm just so picturing fun. Like that scene, like that we were just talking about, Kyle. Like it's like a scene from a movie where your parents are giving your older brothers like this cool game, and then they walk over to you, hand you Shrek. You look at it, you make
you're
this.
Shrek.
You make this, devastated. You make
I'm not
this face.
I made
then,
a big deal.
And
it.
All of a sudden, you hear somebody wants.
I remember feeling kind of like. Why did you buy me this? My parents bought me Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone 1 year. Like, I think the year that game came out. And I remember being like, why the hell did you buy me this? Why on earth would I ever have wanted this? And then I played the whole game in a day and I was like, that was pretty good. That game actually was not bad from when I remember it. Wow. It's probably not great now, but...
I think I played it in, like, a McDonald's one time.
What game?
With their, like, GameCube kiosks.
Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. The original,
The Chamber of Secrets was a good game. My sister actually sat and, like, watched
Play that. Yeah, they weren't bad back then. I mean, games evolved, so now they're probably not good.
Yeah.
But I remember back then thinking, like, oh, this isn't that bad. This is pretty fun.
Yeah. What's the next game we got?
All right, we got three left. Test Drive Off-Road Wide Open.
Have never heard of this.
Moving on. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2X.
Which, yeah, that's the one that's the other one I got at lunch. This is a remake of Tony Hawk 2.
Yeah, and they added in some new stuff. I think they merged both the career modes from Pro Skater and Pro Skater 2 together.
I think so, yeah. Yeah, I didn't actually play the original 2 till a long time later, but I think I emulated it on the PlayStation. But
yeah,
I loved 2X because you can also burn your CDs onto the hard drive of the Xbox.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, yep, yeah. And I remember I got into Avenged Sevenfold whenever they released Waking the Fallen, which was right before when they released their bigger album, City of Evil. And I didn't like City of Evil very much, and then they got huge with the next self-titled, and I started to hate them. But when Waking the Fallen came out, that's all I listened to. And so I would put that on my Xbox, and Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2X has a great soundtrack, but I don't know any song off of it because I was listening to all my own music.
Yeah,
that was a blast.
And that's actually kind of sad because Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 has like one of the best game soundtracks ever.
I wouldn't doubt it. I mean, I fucking love those Tony Hawk's.
We're talking
soundtracks.
About the game that led off with Guerrilla Radio by Rage Against the Machine.
Like, I do remember that. Out. Yeah,
Guerrilla Radio.
And then
turn that shit up.
Tony Hawk just introduced me to a lot of music in general, which is awesome.
Also had a bunch of good songs on, like Bring the Noise by Public Enemy Anthrax.
I know that. Yeah,
When Worlds Collide by Power Man 5000. Some stuff that is not so well known, but like I love like Heavy Metal Winter by Consumed, and like
I don't even know what those.
It's a great song. Evil Eye by Fu Manchu, yeah, like really good.
I know that
songs.
Song.
But yeah, I mean, great game.
Tony Hawk, man.
Tony Hawk, yeah. Bro. Anyway, last game, Trans World Surf. I remember the title. I'd never played it, and I don't feel any sort of doubt, like any regret that I didn't. So, you know,
no regrets.
Anyway, so that's the complete launch lineup there.
That was bigger than I was actually expecting.
Yeah, there was a lot of games that came out with it. I didn't even realize it. Like, I didn't know about a couple of those games. Mostly the like those two off-roading games and stuff. Like, I didn't know about those.
Right.
The ones I remember we specifically
loved off-roading back then.
Yeah, the ones I remember specifically being put out there were like Halo, Fusion Frenzy.
Right. There's some big ones.
I remember. What?
I'm just surprised Brute Force wasn't on there. I thought that was launched, but I guess
no, it wasn't.
No, it's not.
And I thought, and I remember there was a Star Wars game that came out too. I think it was like Star Wars Obi-Wan. I thought that game came out.
That had to have been early.
Yeah, I thought Jet Set Radio Future was a release title too.
That was a Japanese launch title for sure.
Gotcha.
Which I think came out the next year in March or February, Japan.
Right. Yeah,
something like that,
and then just went on to go right downhill till today.
You know? I think the original Xbox sold like literally 1,000 something copies.
Yeah,
that's all.
Xbox has never done well in Japan. And...
something devastating. At least the 360 tried. You know,
yeah,
they made
tried.
An effort.
Yeah.
They were like, "We got JRPGs now," and they're like, "We don't care."
I remember people buying the 360 in Japan exclusively for Infinite Undiscovery, and that was like a big deal. And then that was it.
Yeah.
Oh, what a horrible game.
I know, it's not even good.
Well, that's just the whole thing. Like, I think like the Japanese have a different concept of like what constitutes a good RPG. Like, because they like a lot of stuff that we just hate over here, simple for whatever reason.
Yeah, I mean, some of it's just stuff that doesn't really translate very well.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's the thing. Like, they still like some of the games that we like. You know,
course.
Like Blue Dragon and Infinite Discoveries or Get out, Infinite. Jesus. What is it called?
The Last Remnant.
Lost Odyssey. Lost Odyssey. I don't know how well Last Remnant did, actually.
Yeah, I'm mixing these all up completely.
I know, they're all the fucking same, you know, name-wise, you know, all this random shit. But, yeah, I think what Peter Moore was, his initiative over at Xbox was something that, if they were able to keep going, would have been something that they could have planted the seeds for. But, I mean, you know, it's so expensive getting those deals with like fucking Mistwalker and shit, you know, that was a big fucking deal. So
yeah,
I understand why they stopped.
Okay, so we have been talking about this for a while, so
yep,
I'm gonna need to.
Sorry, I like the Xbox a lot.
Me too. I could go on for a while. Honestly, we could have made this we could have made this the topic of the show if we really wanted to.
I'm sure we could have. Yeah,
but I chose not to. Do we have any last thoughts about it? About the we'll come back to this eventually.
It was a cool box, and I had a lot of fun with Halo 2.
Yeah, I mean, I thought
called somebody the N-word over original Xbox Live.
Well,
I'm pretty sure that's the thing I did. If it isn't, I would be surprised.
You're like, I'm so sorry to that person.
Yep,
Xbox, yeah, Xbox was the first time I learned life wasn't fair when they charged me to use their DVD player.
Xbox.
Oh my God, I remember that. Oh shit.
You had to buy the remote control to use their DVD player.
Oh fuck, that was so dumb.
That was super stupid.
The thing is, my parents actually bought it for me for Christmas, and I remember thinking it was so awesome when I popped in Linkin Park Live in Texas and watched
Linkin Park Live. Oh wow.
But
sign of the times, man.
Exactly. Okay, so we're gonna move on, and guys, I'm gonna have to ask if we try to get through these next two pieces, because the end piece is gonna be another one we're gonna be talking for a while. So we're gonna have to try and get through this one. Ubisoft says it will remove Watch Dogs 2's particularly explicit genitalia.
Bummer.
2 publisher Ubisoft says it plans to release an update for the open world game that removes some of the game's quote unquote particularly explicit full frontal nudity after one player found himself banned from the PlayStation Network because he shared a screenshot of it. In a statement emailed to Polygon, Ubisoft said an upcoming patch for Watch Dogs 2 will address that explicit NPC texture. The company said it's also working with Sony and Microsoft to ensure that players can share content from the game safely. Wow.
Yeah, yeah. You know what's hilarious is I just got myself thinking, like, why, what's the purpose?
I'm looking at this article right now, and I saw the original image where they show the woman who's like passed out on the street, and you can see her private area, like, full, like, without
the whole thing.
You can see the whole cake, the whole thing,
the whole cake.
Jesus,
and eat it too. No, I'm kidding.
No, stop that. Stop.
Well, I was gonna say the whole kit and caboodle, but that just sounds even worse somehow. But anyway, I'm looking at this, and I see the way they covered it up is they used the quote unquote the iconic Watch Dogs hat. So it's just like the guy's black hat.
Oh, I think I've seen that. Yeah,
that's funny.
I will say it's. I think it's weird that like this is something that was in the game, and it was. It looks like it's clipping through, so it looks like it was probably like not intentionally left in there.
Yeah.
So I feel like, sure, I can understand how it like slipped through somehow, but also I feel it's weird that PlayStation just downright banned the guy for sharing it on Twitter. I think that's a bit interesting.
Well, because it shows up on the when you share stuff on Twitter, it shows up on the PSN as well, like on your
right. Yeah,
I
get
or whatever.
How like they figured it out. It's just like, man, that sort of sucks. I'm not saying that they're in the wrong.
They probably have an algorithm.
But yeah, it's just like, man, that sort of sucks. Like if I was that dude, because I totally would have done something like that. I would have shared it and be like, what the fuck, yeah. Ubisoft? And then
yeah.
All your PSN purchases.
I think it happens.
It's like, I just wanted to know.
I mean, they could just.
I'm not trying to share porn.
They can trace it through PSN, because I think he used PS4 share to do it. So it was like, you know. Whereas if he had just taken like a picture of it, I think like you can't prove it's PlayStation unless like.
Prove it, you can't.
But yeah, I mean, it's I actually watched one of the videos that they put up. Like, I mean, you straight up, this guy gets up and you can see this dude's dick just hanging out. Like, it's like,
oh, there's dick in there too.
Yeah.
Oh well, that's good. Equal opportunity.
Okay. Equal. Yeah, equality, man. That's what we got to push.
Oh, that's so funny. Yeah. Oh my God.
Anyway, so that's.
I'm just like, why are either of these in there?
I don't know, dude.
Not that I'm like a prude or anything, I just find it very strange.
It's just such an odd thing to put into this game about hacking. Yeah. I don't know.
They're like, Nintendo wouldn't do this game about hacking. It's gonna have pussies and dicks in it. Like, all right.
Kyle, don't say that. I mean, we're gonna be seeing next thing you know, we're gonna be seeing like
trying to give up a segue for you, but no, you just took that in a different direction.
I'm just getting like
Mario's dick's flying around. What have you done?
No, I'm more picturing like a naked Link with like a flag running around in Breath of the Wild. Jesus. Anyway, moving on to our next piece real quick. NES Classic shortages rile fans, line the pockets of scalpers. Basically, just to put this into short here, I already heard a couple of my friends talking about this. Apparently, you can't get an NES Classic anywhere. It's been scooped up, and now scalpers are selling it at a way higher price. Like, it's normally $60. Like, I think the cheapest you can get it is like $80, but they're averaging around like two. So it's like $200. So it's like, all right, what the fuck are you doing? This is
normal Nintendo.
Yeah, and it would piss me off if I really cared. Like, I don't really care about this to start with, so I'm just like, whatever, you know.
Yeah, but I think it's a little weird just because like the timing of it, you know, this is supposed to be a holiday thing. $60 is a bit steep for this sort of a machine because like you can actually go out and buy a comparable Genesis Mini that's third party right now, like on a Walmart shelf, and it's like I think only $30 and it has more games. It's like 80 games. So yeah. Like if you're trying to aim towards like some sort of, obviously not a stocking stuffer, because $60 for a stocking stuffer is probably outside of the range of most household incomes, but just the fact that like I feel like this is not supposed to be like the big holiday gift that you would get somebody as opposed to a console. Yeah. So with that in mind, it is weird that like they're trying to make this artificial scarcity factor in it. But I mean, you know, Nintendo does that really well, and then it makes everybody want to glob onto it like it's, you know, Yeezy shoes or something, you know. So as a strategy, I get it, but also it's
what shoes?
Well, I'm sure that they're also gonna do what the other console manufacturers did, and they, of course, like they disappeared at launch, but they're probably gonna put out a couple more at Black Friday. That's actually how I got my first PS4. But
I mean, yeah, I've heard reports from people that like who pre-ordered or when the shipments went out and like they got it later, like they've already gotten confirmed that they're getting it soon. So
yeah, I wouldn't worry too much about this, but I just, you know, it's just typical Nintendo fare pretty much. I guess the only reason I got a little angry is because like I was kind of thinking about like, and this is just a crazy idea I had, because my parents are like not into video games at all, and like they kind of look at me like I'm silly. So I
getting it with them.
I was thinking like maybe buying them this, because it's like it's so ridiculously simple. I'm like, guys, there's four directions and two fucking buttons. If you can't figure this out, then you shouldn't be driving a car. Just plug it into the TV for them and leave it and just see what happens. And then, you know, in a perfect world, I'd be walking out of my bedroom one morning and my dad's sitting there playing Mario. But
he's like, you know, I already beat this and the Doki Doki whatever.
Well, he's a lot like me in the fact that he just starts swearing up a storm when he's not winning. So it's just like, you know, Sam, hear the God fucking damn it,
Mario, you piece of fucking shit! You're a goddamn fucking plumber.
Are you?
You're a lunatic.
Yeah,
I
learned a lot.
It's weird though that the controller ports are like, or the controller length on the wire is so ridiculously short.
Yeah, I have a theory about this, because everyone in the IGN offices was complaining about how short the cord is.
Yeah.
And my theory is that they wanted you to have the console like on the carpet and like you sit close to it like you would when you were a kid. You know what I mean?
I agree with that, but it's just
I think it's stupid.
It's such
too.
A complicated silly thing to replicate that same sort of sense, because it's so short it's like almost impossible.
Well, I agree. It's dumb.
It's like 3 feet, right?
But that's my theory on it. Because then, of all the people that would do something like that, it's Nintendo, right?
Yeah.
So, like, no, we wanted you to relive that experience of sitting cross-leg on the carpet. Like, no, look. I want to sit on my couch.
Yeah.
I'm a crone man.
Exactly.
But I will say, having seen a bit of it in action, the games look real good in HDMI. Like, they look crisp. And, real nice. Yeah. So it's cool. It made me go, but yeah.
I'm gonna leave
the controller length is a bit like it sucks.
I'm gonna leave emulators out of this discussion anyway. Do you have any last thoughts about this?
I mean,
I think it's cool.
It's
cool. It'll come back on Switch. It will resolve itself.
I think this time, I say maybe even 2 or 3 months from now, you'll see them everywhere. I don't think.
Will.
Yeah.
You will.
Anyway, speaking of more Nintendo stuff, and possibly, I mean, I guess you could have called that a Nintendo screw up, but this is definitely could end up being a huge screw up for them. Zelda Breath of the Wild to potentially miss Nintendo Switch launch. Apparently, Emily Rogers has leaked some information saying that with the localization schedule with the game, that they're still continuing localization through the end of 2016. And then after that, four to six months of testing will follow, unquote, before the game launches. That would place it, if the Switch's release date is to be believed, which is in March, that would place it at least a month after, potentially 3 months after the Switch's release, maybe even further, who knows? It's Nintendo. So what do we think about the game that was kind of assumed to be a launch title, sort of, for the Switch, possibly not launching with the console?
So there's a couple of things to, I think, keep in mind when we talk about this. Because first off, like, Nintendo never announced that this was going to be at any time other than 2017. It, knowing the fact that they had said it was coming in 2016, and I think the original launch date was, like, winter 2015, if I'm correct. So this does seem like, okay, you guys are pushing it a lot. But you know, they never said anything about it, and knowing that it's going to come out simultaneously, it's like, okay, I can understand where they're coming from. Also, what's important is that they hit the first year and have games coming out continuously over that time. So if this is not going to be their launch title, their big launch, perhaps that gap's filled by Mario, which people have speculated, perhaps maybe a Metroid, which has also been on the docs, supposedly. So the point is if Zelda's not hitting that launch, another game has to. And if they do that, think about that. That's two really big Nintendo gets throughout the year, which anyone buying the console, let's say day one, probably going to be satisfied for a month, two, you know, and then eventually get Zelda, which is probably going to last them quite a while as well. So I think this is something that's not too big of a deal. Upsetting, 100%. I agree with that. But mm-hmm. I don't think it's that big of a problem.
Do you think it could potentially be that Mario game that we saw in the reveal?
Honestly, I'm rooting for yes.
Yeah.
Just because, like, first off, I'm dying for, like, a standard, like, Mario successor game.
For sure.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's just been too long since Galaxy 1. Because Galaxy 2 is great, but, you know, it's just more Galaxy. And,
yeah.
And the Wii U didn't really have that. So, yeah, exactly.
I really enjoyed the hell out of 3D World. Like, I thought it was...
Yeah, and I don't want to disparage that at all, because I think that's a great game. I do honestly Absolutely. Think that's a great game. But, you know, it's still a little different, you know? So, like, it doesn't scratch that itch quite similarly.
I want a Mario Sunshine, too. That's really what I want.
Dude, that'd be so amazing.
I've gone on vacation again, and the island got dirty again.
Damn it, somehow Mario. Baby Bowser got a brush again. And they somehow snuck a giant mech in here again.
Again.
Mechs and Mario.
It's just called Mario Sunshine again.
Sunshine.
But, yeah, I mean, I pretty much share the exact same sentiment, Kyle. I mean, Nintendo does this really borderline annoying thing where they just let these rumors get out of control without saying anything.
Yeah,
so,
they really need to...
They need to be more on top of that. But at the same time...
It's annoying, yeah.
It's really a little dance they have to do. They have to say... if they just came out and said, look, it's probably not going to be coming out in March, and just be vague about it and say, like, look, for sure, it's not coming out in March, then that would probably make it a little bit easier on people. I think this is just a leak, and it was probably intended to be said in January. So,
yeah, probably.
You know, whatever. That's why I'm not, like, super mad about it. I'm more just looking at it from a strategy point of view. Like, there has to be something else. Like, it can't just be like what they did with the Wii U, where they put out New Super Mario Brothers for the Wii U. That was a great game. Don't get me wrong, not a bad game. It's a good game, but that is not a launch title. That is not, like, you know,
at least the big one.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, what was the other one? Nintendo Land was the other?
Oh, dear God. Yeah. Ugh, I didn't even play that. Yeah. I remember they were giving away for free because I bought the Wii U when they did that offer where if you buy the system, you get a free game. And mm-hmm. one of them was Nintendo Land, and I almost laughed. I think I ended up picking Wind Waker HD. I never got through it, though. I only played, like, a little bit of it. But definitely if I get some time, if I get, like, a vacation ever, I'll sit down and play it. But,
the last thing I want to say about Nintendo, because not to make this political, I'm not going to delve into that. It's just, it reminds me of how Hillary Clinton deals with the media, is how Nintendo deals with this. It's like, I'm not going to talk about it. No, that's fine. Let it happen. Let all the rumors happen. That's fine. And then they come out, like, at the very end of everything and try to set things straight. And then, it's just frustrating.
And then Xbox comes out with a handheld saying they're going to make handhelds great again.
Xbox just grabs somebody's pussy.
Remember when everybody was like, the X-Boy, that's going to be a thing? It's like, first of all, they'd never call it that because that's the worst.
Listen, the polls show the Xbox is in no position to win this election, okay?
No.
There's just no way. Oh, God. Yeah. Xbox won the election. And
Phil Spencer's come out saying, we're going to have the best games ever.
He says that already.
It's going to be great.
That's true. Yeah, that's the thing they say. This is the greatest games lineup of video games in the history of videos.
It's like, you're not the PS2. Yeah. You need to cool it, all right?
Now that I'm thinking about it, we recorded this podcast as the election results were coming in. And we're now...
The last one? I know. Yeah. That's why at the end we get all sad and quiet.
Yep. Okay.
Pretty
so
much came in.
With that note, we're gonna stop talking about the election because
let's move back. I've coped enough. I've cried enough.
I have a lot of life I have left to live. So
so true.
So Do we have any last thoughts on Zelda Breath of the Wild not being possibly on the Switch launch lineup?
That sucks.
It's still going to be good. So, you know.
Still sucks.
Okay. That's good enough for me. All right. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, we have now moved on to the topic of the show. Sorry.
Magic's still in the air.
Okay. So my topic this week, and it kind of, I'm not going to pretend like there was like this huge reason for it, but I was thinking about topics we could talk about this week. And we talked last week about games that we like, but we can't recommend. And that got me thinking, like, what would be something that we could definitely play off of that theme? And my idea was based off of a couple games I played that everyone else loves, but I, for whatever reason, just couldn't get into. I think this started with, I don't know, I think I was 14, 15. I had a PlayStation 2 by that point, and I borrowed Final Fantasy VII from one of my friends. And I managed to get through Midgar, and then I the minute I got out, I was like, all right, I
can't. So the first minute.
It's not the first minute. Midgar is like a good.
Midgar's
like a good hour, isn't it? I mean,
Midgar is
literally the town.
It's longer than that.
Yeah,
it's longer than, it's like an hour. It's like, no,
it's longer than an hour.
I'm talking when you escape, like once you escape, and I was just like, all right, well, I'm kind of.
Yeah, the first time you leave Midgar, I think it's like 5 hours in. So I think, yeah.
Okay, so I put a decent amount of time into it.
I thought you were saying you when you got to Midgar. I'm like, so when you got off the train
beginning?
Gosh, you idiot.
I will also say that, so I was watching the intro cinematic, and then I see them jump off the train. I was like, holy fuck, that looks terrible. Like, it looks, to quote zero punctuation, it looked like someone tried to inflate something by farting at it. But, because the polygons just look really, like, it's the same, the N64 effect as well. Like, they just, it does not look very good.
Yeah, it's like sprites, but in 3D.
Yeah, no. Whereas, like, I thought, like, the animations in the fight scenes were actually really, really good. Like, I liked the way they looked there. So I was like, why can't you just make them look like this all the time? But
they didn't hate.
Anyway, gentlemen, the topic, like I said, is what is a game that everyone else likes, but you tried to play, but you just could not get into for whatever reason?
Grand Theft Auto.
See, this is something I don't get either, because in my personal opinion, Grand Theft Auto is like one of the greatest games of all time. So delve into this, please.
Dude, I just don't like them. Like, they come off, like, the writing comes off as just like mean. Like, half the missions are totally useless. They're just like, hey man, let's go find this guy stole my weed, and you're like, all right. And then you like go to this house and just blow people away for no reason. And then it's like, thanks for that. And then it ends. And it's always like, cousin, let's go bowling. And that's a whole mission. And you're like, what does this have to do with
Nico,
anything?
My
literally
cousin.
Anything. Nico, 50-50, pod racing, Suburba. It's just like, man, I don't know. I just don't like them. Like, they bore me. They're always super long. Replaying Red Dead recently made me remember why I really dislike Rockstar games. It's because they're so long and bloated. Like Red Dead Redemption has the same problem, where it's like, where the hell is Javier Escuela? Like, will someone please, for the love of Christ, just tell me where Javier Escuela is? And they're like, I will tell you later, my friend. But for now, we need to go hijack this train. And you're like, no, just tell me where Javier Escuela is.
I will agree that in that era of Rockstar games, like, the storytelling becomes very much like stalling to get to the next point.
Yeah.
I would say, though, Grand Theft Auto 5 fixes a lot of that.
That's exactly what I was
saying. I think it moves at a good pace. Yeah.
Yeah. I will say, as somebody who kind of falls, because I'm guessing, Kyle, you're like a Grand Theft Auto fan for the most part. You play a lot.
Yeah, I love GTA. So
I fall in the middle of both of you. Like, I played the only Grand Theft Autos I've played. I played Vice City for fun at one of my friend's house, where I literally just like ran around and just did stupid shit. Like, I didn't like actually play the game.
Most people. Yeah.
I played a little bit of San Andreas because I managed to sneak it past my mom when I was that young. And I think I got around that, like, it was very early in the game where you get that scene where the guy's at the drive thru and he's ordering that super long order. And then the drive by happens and all that. But And then the only game I ever played, like, straight through, I sat down and just went through, was Grand Theft Auto 5. And it made me kind of want to go back and play the other ones, but at the same time, I was like, you know what? Given, like, how I remember those other games, those games probably weren't going to grab me in the same way that Grand Theft Auto 5 did, because they definitely did a bigger push on, like, I don't know, kind of like its immersion factor, I guess.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I agree with that. You made the right choice, honestly. Yeah.
One of the things I really loved about it was that it, and this is totally asinine, like, not at all needed, but they let you play your own music on the PC version. Like, you could actually, like,
oh yeah.
So yeah. But, like, within the game's directory, like, you could just, like, they actually told you, like, hey, if you want to do this, do it. And they actually had a radio station that was dedicated
right,
to that.
All of your stuff.
Yeah,
that's really helpful. So,
and they were, I will say though, Grand Theft Auto 5's music, like, in game,
yeah,
fucking so good. It's good. Oh, stuff, man. Yeah. I remember.
I will say for the record that I have not touched GTA 5 once, like, period. And
since
it's only because I've
price,
touched.
I wouldn't recommend it. But
it's only because I've played every other one, thinking maybe this is the one that will get me into it, and it never
right.
is.
If it's just ever cheap, I would actually recommend it, just for the fact that, like, it is just a fun game in and of itself to, like, go and wreck shit in that sandbox. Because you've also got GTA Online and all that stuff. But I mean, like Dave was saying, those games have definitely, like, you can tell that they've aged beyond just, like, a technical aspect, because a lot of those games, like, you can tell where the innovation comes in, like in San Andreas, where you have, like, this weird, you can get fat if you want, and you have to work out and stuff. And it was one of the few games that I would ever, like, actually think about, like, my character, even though it's not, like, a heavy RPG. And that avatar that you explore the world in is pretty impactful, both personally and to the world itself. Vice City in particular is probably my favorite, just because I'm a big fan of style and aesthetic, and that is just, you know, Miami Vice the game. So that's always been something that I've really enjoyed. But, like, just quality wise, I think GTA 5 is really good. But what you're saying, Josh, I think is, I understand what you're saying, and I get where you're coming from, so I'm not going to argue with it. It's just, I could, every time I've ever touched a Grand Theft Auto, excluding, like, 1 and 2, because they're very different games, and, like, maybe Chinatown Wars, I always get, like, so enthralled in those games. And I think, especially Rockstar now, I think they're untouchable in terms of a studio.
I wouldn't necessarily go that far.
That's probably my biggest one, if you had to ask me, is Grand Theft Auto, because I just have never...
That's a big one.
Never clicked with me, and I've never been able to get into it every single time I've tried. And I'm not someone who just, like, I played GTA 3 once, I tried. Like, I've played all of them, and that, except for 5, obviously.
I gotcha.
But,
right.
And I've just been like, man, I just, like, I've tried, and it just doesn't, it's not, it doesn't click with me. I don't know what it is.
And Josh, I'll echo Kyle's sentiment. If you do see it for cheap, like, let's say it goes on sale on Steam or something, I definitely recommend picking it up. I think it'll change your mind, honestly. Like, because this is coming from somebody who doesn't love the series. Like, I couldn't get into Vice City, couldn't get into San Andreas. I picked up 5 thinking, okay, maybe I'll give this one a shot, and I did. So, I put 60 hours into it. So, you know. But
yeah,
that's
those
just
games.
Like,
yeah,
everyone to each his own on that, though.
For sure.
So
I have one that I. Sorry, Dave. Do you want to?
No, I was gonna say. So, Kyle, what do you have?
Okay. Yeah. This one's a hard one to think about, just because, I mean, you guys know me. I feel like I'm overly positive about stuff. Like, I try intentionally sometimes, like, to just get into a game, because, like, I like appreciating the games that. Like, for their faults included, you know, not just their qualities.
I mean,
so.
I think even the titling of this topic is very positive. Like, it's very positive thing. I just say that you can't get into not necessarily popular games that suck. But
yeah, that's true. Taking a positive slant on it. But so it did take a lot of thinking for this. And so, like, I don't have a whole lot that are necessarily, like, as big as Josh. But one that I did think about is so I do enjoy fighting games a lot. 3D fighting games in particular are not my favorite cup of tea, but I like a ton of them. You know, like Dead or Alive is one that I consider myself pretty dang good at.
I would echo that sentiment with you. I'm a 2D fighting game guy.
Yeah, I don't know what it is, but, you know, like a 2D, especially a sprite-based one, it just feels so good.
Yeah.
But, like, I really enjoy Tekken. I really enjoy Blaze Blue. I love, the Marvel
Guilty
games.
I love
like
the aesthetic
about.
Of
Guilty
all
Gear,
those
yeah,
games,
Guilty
yeah.
Gear is great. Yeah, and so, like, I like a lot of those games, but for some reason, I have never liked Street Fighter. And that's like, you know, the top tier, you know, it's pretty much the game that everybody cares about when it comes to Evo, outside of like Smash Brothers, you know? Yep. And so
I don't want to interrupt you. I don't mean to interrupt you, Kyle, but I just wanted to insert the random fact that apparently Tekken sells better than Street Fighter, though.
Which is weird. Yeah, yeah. I don't understand. I think that may have something to do with its attachment rates in Japan.
Yeah.
Just because I know Japan does like Tekken a lot. And, you know, I can't really delve into why necessarily I like Tekken more than Street Fighter from a systematic or angle, you know, anything like that.
Yeah.
The reason I like Tekken is because I grew up with, like, Tag Tournament, in my opinion, is one of the greatest 3D fighting games yeah. ever. That and like Virtua Fighter, I would say those are like the 3D fighting games, and Street Fighter of course is a 2D fighting game, but I still lump it together with those games for some reason. I guess just because it's you know rendered in 3D now, but outside of that whole thing, even with Street Fighter V sort of, you know, shaky launch, outside of all that, every time I play Street Fighter I never really feel that same sort of connection I do to any other fighting game, because to me, it always feels very upfront that, like, okay, this is a numbers game. This is about strategies, and this is about figuring stuff out. Like, I do not ever connect with a character. I never think about anything like that. It's just like, oh, okay, if I want to be good, I need to figure out who's, you know, probably going to be a good counter to the whoever's being used the most, like Ryu or whatever, you know? So that's just a game series that, even going back to Street Fighter II, Hyper Fighting, like, I remember playing that as a kid and being like, this game is fucking sucks. And then I would go and play Mortal Kombat. So yeah, I don't know. That's just one of them.
That makes perfect sense. I mean, I've actually played the only Street Fighter I've played for any sort of amount of time was, I think, Street Fighter 2 Turbo for the Game Boy Advance. And
2 Turbo.
Yeah, I remember that was just like a good time waster. I didn't really like see it as like, oh my god, this game's fucking amazing. But I also have another story to tell, because this is really funny. I was talking to one of my friends back during, and this will be relevant, I promise. I was talking to one of my friends. This was like Xbox PS2 era, and he was saying, "Oh yeah, like, do you hear Eric had his PS2 broke down?" I was like, "Oh, what happened?" He was like, "Oh, he put in this copy of Tekken Tag and it just broke." And for the longest time, I thought it was actually the characters of Tekken playing tag. So, like, just going, "You're it." like we're like you actually,
I would,
like,
play that game.
You know what? It's not like weird games like that don't exist. King of Fighters Sky Stage is a game that is a spaceship shmup, but instead of spaceships, you're flying actual King of Fighters characters. So, like, there's weird shit like that that exists.
I don't know. Right. Oh, all right, I get it. That's amazing.
I'm done with no.
That's so funny.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
What did you say?
I just said I'm done.
No, what did Josh say?
I said that's so funny.
Jesus Christ.
Now I'm just confused. Just move on.
Anyway.
My brain's going
to
break.
So, this one I say because I have to admit it to myself at some point, because I've tried to get into it, really, like, I've honestly given it my...
Oh, good, we're having this conversation.
I've honestly... No, there's a couple games, dude. There's a couple games. I came up with this topic specifically because it actually is pretty relevant to me, because there are games... There are a couple of games out there that are popular that I just can't do. I just can't do them. And here's an entire game series, and honestly, I'm going to say, before I say what it is, I'm going to say that I respect this game series. I understand what contributions it's made to gaming in general. The fact that a lot of people will source some of these games as their games of forever, definitely games of the year, games of the system, whatever. The game series I can't get into is The Legend of Zelda. I can't do it.
Wow.
I did not play Ocarina of Time during the N64 era, and I didn't go. I think I went back to it a little bit later. And remember when I was talking earlier about the strategy guide era, and how that was, Zelda's were the games you needed strategy guides for, because they told you in like little like text box cutscenes what you had to do, and I just never found myself connecting with that. It was always just like, wait, what the fuck did he say? Shit. I have to go back and either talk to him, or like the person wouldn't even say what you had to do anymore. It'd be like a different thing that they were saying now. I'd be like, fuck.
I take it you never got invested in the backstory of Hoot Hoot?
I no.
Dude, that elf was cheap, right?
So
the character has like no backstory. That was the joke. But...
Oh, okay. W- He
was the owl in Ocarina of Time.
That, he had a head that was both on upside down.
Who, like, if you actually didn't read, because Nintendo felt like punishing you when it said, like, do you want to hear that again? Like, if you were just tapping the A button, you would just be caught in this hoot hoot loop.
That's funny.
It was the worst.
I know about that. Nintendo used to do that with a lot of their games, if I remember correctly. But,
my only. That was the worst.
Sorry. What'd you say, Josh?
No, I'm done.
Okay.
I'm done.
I'm going to say my only, like, my serious attempt to get into Zelda was I bought Twilight Princess for GameCube 3 or 4 years ago. And I sat down. My friend I actually went over to my friend's house, who's, like, huge into Zelda. And he would sit there, and if I got stuck, he would tell me, no, you have to go there, Dave. Like, you know, and, like, guide me through the game. And I think I got to the temple where everything's up in the air, I believe. And I don't know. I don't remember too much about it anymore. There was a lot of traps and shit, and I just got pissed off and stopped. But I got pretty far. And that was the only. And I just don't have, like, a real desire to go back. And like I said, I tried Zelda Wii U, and I think I got to the point where the bird takes your sister, and I'm on the boat, and I'm just like,
you mean
like, literally
Skyward Sword?
No, I'm talking about Wind Waker.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Yeah, Skyward Sword, never tried. Yeah, I mean. Honestly, like I said, I prefaced this and said, look, I get it. I get this game. Everyone, like, a lot of people love these games. I just could. I tried. I honestly tried.
Is it just because, like, they're too, like, obtuse and, like, it's hard to follow where they want you to go?
That's a big part of it. I think that was my primary frustration when playing Twilight Princess. I had to basically, you know, go back to my friend Matt and just, like, Matt, where the fuck do I have to go? And he'd be like, oh, you're like, where are you? So, okay, I'm here.
I don't know why he gave you that of all the...
Well, no, that was my choice. That was my choice.
Oh, you picked the wrong one. Because I don't like that one. I know a lot of people that really love Zelda who do not like Twilight Princess.
Twilight's all right.
Well, I mean, I tried Ocarina as well, like, a while further back. And I just, like, it just didn't really catch with me, really. Same with Majora. I mean,
Zelda, much like Dark Souls, has a language. And, like, you have to kind of, like, know the language of it. And then after that, you either like it or you don't. Most people tend to like it. But yeah, I can understand, like, not... Yeah. I understand you being like, it's obtuse, because it kind of is.
Yeah, like, it's interesting you bring that up, because now that I think about it, there haven't been many... I think there hasn't been a single time I've played a Zelda game without a walkthrough, I don't think. Like, at some point, bringing one up. Because, yeah, I always get stuck at some point. Except for, like, Ocarina, because I played it
so many
times at this
point.
I'm going to
try with Breath.
I'm definitely, yeah, I want to, for sure. Just because since it's also exploration-based and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But, that is interesting you bring that up. Because, like, yeah, I can understand if you didn't grow up with the seminal Zelda games like Ocarina or fucking Link to the Past or anything like that, returning to those games at this point in time and not being able to, like, get it from the get-go, I do get how, like, oh, okay, maybe it feels like this just isn't for me.
Well, that too, so, and, Brian, our good friend Brian, he was just, like, going back and replaying. He's never played the original Zelda, so he went and played it, and he was saying how he just, like, he was surprised that you could, like, blow up walls with bombs. Like, that's not something that they, like, tell you or whatever. He was looking at a walkthrough at some point, and he's like, how was anyone ever supposed to figure out that, like, this blue candle burns?
I mean, the first one
stuff. You know what
there
I mean?
There were a lot of games like that at that time, though.
Yeah, but I mean, the series itself sort of behaves like that. Like, they don't outwardly tell you stuff. Like, most of the time, they're just like...
The thing that comes up with for me, actually, and I only know this because I think I was watching the review done by Zero Punctuation. He brings up, in Ocarina of Time, apparently there's this thing you're trying to get a fish to eat you or something, and you have to, like, do something very specific to make him do
that. Oh, yeah, for that, the third dungeon. Yeah. You have to grab a fish or grab a thing and then, like, carry it to him or whatever. Yeah. And then he sucks you in. You're like, woo! Yeah.
But yeah,
I don't remember that because I've beat that game a million times. See?
Once again, I will say I get it. I'm not slamming the series at all. I'm just saying I couldn't get into it.
Dude, I get it.
Yeah.
I'm not saying you're wrong.
Go.
Because I definitely agree to a degree.
To a degree.
Yeah.
I think Kyle just...
Even though, as someone who likes it.
Yeah, man. So I was thinking, I mean, I have a couple more I want to talk about, but I want to see if you guys have other ones that you want to bring up before I bring up my other one, because I think I'm just going to piss Josh off twice tonight. So, well, I didn't piss you off with Zelda, but I think I'm going to piss you off with this next one.
It's going to be Kingdom Hearts, probably.
No, Kingdom Hearts is one of my favorite games, so that's not going to come up.
Oh, okay.
I think Kyle, I'm not sure if Kyle, are you good? He can't talk.
Nope.
There we go.
Okay. Back. I don't know what happened. I disconnected from the server, and then it was like trying to reconnect over and over. It wasn't working. So.
Your internet pooped.
I'm back now, so.
Yeah. I was just asking if there's any other games that, because I have one more I definitely want to bring up, and there's probably going to be more as we continue to talk. But I wanted to give you guys a chance to name a couple if you have them.
I have a short one.
Sure.
That won't take too long. Yeah. It's also not very contentious. I know this is a pretty well-regarded thing, but I think it's a popular game. So I think God of War is really bad. I've never liked it.
I can understand
Not just because of
God of War.
I am totally fine with people that do. It's not the normal complaint that gets to me about it. Because the normal idea is Kratos is just mad all the time and is annoying. It's just look at him rip dudes' heads off and whatever. That's fine. I don't, that doesn't bother me. It gets, a little annoying as the series has gone on, but I've always found there are very few action games like that I really enjoy. And I think God of War does a very slow-paced, boring third-person action game. And the ones I like, obviously, are fast-paced. Bayonetta, I think, is the greatest action game.
Yeah.
Third-person character action game of all time. Devil May Cry, very close second because it's so close. But those are the games that I like. So when I play through God of War, even I tried God of War 1 again 2 months ago. And because... I've been getting into emulation like I've been talking about endlessly, I feel like, but it just doesn't click with me at all. I tried 2 because I hear 2 is better, and it's I just don't even care. It's very boring to me. Just from a mechanical standpoint, the Chains of Olympus, I think, are just, it's just spamming a button. And then I know later on in the game, things get more complicated, as all action games do, but even when I look at something like Prince of Persia, which is a game that I do like, yeah. Prince of Persia has an interesting time mechanic to work with. There are other things outside of its core mechanics that make it fun for me. So
yeah,
God of War I just find really boring.
No, I'm the same way. I think I enjoyed it a little bit when my friend actually had me come over and play 2 at one point. And I was this is fun, but I have no real need to buy this game. I didn't feel a need to buy 3, and I'm not even all that excited for 4, to be honest.
Oh really?
Yeah, I'm just not. I mean, it was a cool reveal. I thought as somebody who loves God, God of War, that must have been fucking awesome to see. That must have been holy shit.
I mean, I think even for people that aren't huge fans of it, I think it's because it represents a tonal and gameplay shift for the series. It's growing up a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's my only. That's the only thing that piqued my interest is just the fact that it's so different and so unexpected. With that said, I will say God of War 4 is just The Last of Us mixed with God of War. So
sure.
We'll see how it is.
But I mean, you could say that about any game that's sort of brooding. You can just be oh, it's just this with The Last of Us. It's
what I feel like Sony's doing hardcore. I think they're mixing every game they have with Last of Us because everybody loved that. And so now every game's going to be dramatic.
You're going to see Ratchet and Clank walking around.
I was just going to say Ratchet and Clank.
Clank's going to have a beard.
Yeah, somebody's going to get their face blown off with a shotgun. And
Captain Quark, no!
Captain Quark.
Oh, that's good. That's hilarious. God. Yeah.
All right, Josh, how about you?
Shit, way to put me on the spot.
If you don't have one, just, it doesn't matter.
Right now I'm trying to think of something.
I can bring up another one if you want.
All right, bring it out.
All right, time to potentially piss you off. I could not get into Dishonored.
Dude, you're not the first person who has told me I can't get into.
Well, do you want to know what the reason is? And it's not the game. The gameplay is actually not one of the main reasons. I mean, the gameplay I think is actually pretty good. It's run of the mill to me. It's not oh my god, this is so deep and amazing, and I love it.
It's,
I want to keep playing
it. What's the genre? It's the same genre as BioShock and Deus Ex. It's simulation or first person simulation or something like that.
And much like like, granted, I got into Bioshock pretty, like, I completed Bioshock, so I consider that a game I was able to get into. I couldn't get into Deus Ex Human Revolution, and I just didn't even bother with Mankind Divided. But as far as Dishonored goes, for whatever reason, and you guys can call me petty for this, I don't care, but the the reason I couldn't get into Dishonored was its aesthetics. It was like,
oh really?
Yeah,
that was the one thing that tied me to it.
I didn't like it at all. Like, it's just like, and it's not like there's nothing I can say that, like, I'm saying I can understand why some people would like it. I'm not sitting here like, oh my god, this
I like
is
it
because
it's unique.
I guess it's like it's unique, but it's not
looks
like
Dishonored. It doesn't look like anything else.
That's true, and I'll give it that. And I, but at the same time, I just don't like that look. I just don't like. It's really.
It's fine, dude. It's subjective.
Yeah, it's like maybe it's just like the proportion, the body proportions might be a little weird, or just like
you're not wrong for like for not liking green beans. You know, it's like
how dare you?
Fine.
And I guess like the other thing is like the story didn't really grab me that much. I mean the
oh my god, I love the story.
I think I got
game.
I got sucked in a little bit more when the twist happens, but you know like that first like 10 hours where you're just going through. And just doing
10 hours. Oh my god.
Is it 10 hours? I don't know, dude.
No.
It's been a while. How much is how many you, how long is are the missions before the twist? How like it's like a couple
there's
missions. It's like
4 maybe?
Four? Yeah.
So 4 like 3 to 4 hours?
Okay.
That game's only like 6 hours long.
I'm overshooting.
Pretty sure.
Either way, my point is that before the twist, I was just sitting there like, you know, just like really just not enjoying it at all. Twist happens, I'm like, okay, I'm a little more engaged now. And then I think I went to the first level after the twist and I was just like, I'm done. I don't need to do this anymore. I don't know what came over me. I was just like, whatever, I'm done. I don't want to do this.
But, I have a really big problem with games that offer stealth and action at the same time, and I always just get frustrated with that. I either want one or I don't want one or the other. I want just wait, that sounds weird. I only want one. I don't want.
But then how do you reconcile like Metal Gear, cuz it does both?
No, I think Metal Gear is much more a stealth game. Like, of course,
well, sure,
you can get yourself
into
situations where you can just run and gun. You know, the run and gun mechanics are terrible. So yeah. it's definitely not that's not the intended route. But in a game like a Dishonored or a game like Deus Ex, for instance, it for me, I feel like I want to play it stealth wise because I think stealth is always the, you know, the lesser of two roads, even though it's not really, everybody wants to play stealth. But in terms of normal games, like, well, I just feel like most games offer just the run and gun route. So when they offer you a stealth route, people are like, okay, I want to try that.
Yeah.
But
I just say
never,
like a lot of people don't like, they're like, I'm bad at stealth, so I never want to do it.
Well, either way, I just feel like whichever one you pick, it doesn't satisfyingly give you enough reasons to pick that and then also tell you why you're fine to not play the other way or whatever. I always have this tug and pull relationship when I'm playing a game like that, so it's always tough for me.
Yeah. No, I definitely feel the same way about it, and that's probably another reason I wasn't able to get into Deus Ex, like the Human Revolution, because like I wanted to sell so badly, but I found myself always getting caught and always getting into the run and gun type stuff. And
yeah.
I just didn't think Deus Ex really worked very well in its run and gun.
Like, the first one, yeah, I didn't like very much. I gave it a shot just because I really enjoy the world and stuff. And the first Deus Ex game, of course, is so historic. I do want to play Mankind Divide, though. And hearing Josh talk so well about it, like in the future, I might try and pick it up and play them out.
I like both those games. You know what I like about that genre, which is what I guess why I like games like that, like those, is that the genre, the mechanics aren't so much like mechanics as they are just tools for you to engage with the world.
I 100% agree with that.
Which is my biggest issue with all of the Arkham games, the Batman Arkham games, is like Batman is known for having all his tools, yet every situation has its one basic like solution, as opposed to like, here's all of Batman's tools, solve the problem, right?
Well, let me ask you, Josh, were you into the Arkham games? Like, did you like the Arkham games?
I love Asylum.
Okay.
City, I enjoyed. Knight, I was very much not a fan
I'm almost
of.
The same way.
Although actually, I think Knight was all right.
I didn't play Knight, but I'm the same way about Asylum versus City. Like, I thought Asylum worked better because it was more focused.
Because like, it's like make a third person Metroidvania game with Batman and they like pull it off.
Yeah.
But then when they give you so much, like the problem is that when they give you so much freedom in City, again, they don't follow it up with the Deus Ex Dishonored BioShock model of just giving you tools to interact with the world as opposed to like this Goblin is Hulk. A stealth encounter, this is a fighting encounter, this is a boss encounter. You know what I mean?
I'd argue there are occasions in both Arkham Knight and Arkham City where like you have a puzzle set up in front of you and it's not necessarily about
but I'm not necessarily saying it like they're puzzles. I'm saying like the world isn't like the things that you are given aren't set up for your choice. Like, you know what I mean? It's like this scenario is designed to be a combat scenario and this scenario is designed to be a stealth scenario. That's and they're going saying. To tell you to do that. And there's a fail state if you get caught and stuff
but
like
that's
that.
That's why I like,
I don't like that. I want,
just let me pitch you. Cause I feel like in a game like Dishonored, you can run about this any way you would like, which allows you to essentially freeform the entire experience of the encounter, right? So you sort of have these emergent experiences that create the storytelling for you personally, other than the fact that Dishonored has its own story. And then in a game like Batman Arkham Knight, for instance, just because it's the most recent one, so it's the freshest in my mind, there are situations where, like, let's say we get into a stealth encounter. If I was just given tools to work with like Dishonored, I would not feel like every encounter was as smartly set up like Batman would do it. And because these are structurally set up, they want you to feel smart. By the time I finish and am done and like I clear the room without anyone ever hearing me, right, I feel like Batman much more so than I feel like I would in the reverse. That's just why I really
appreciate dude, like the feeling of like getting through a Dishonored level, never being seen, caught, or killing anyone is like the greatest feeling. Like it's so
good.
But
isn't that more fewer and far in between than it would be, let's say, if every situation was structured in a way that would make you maybe not feel that as impactfully, but nevertheless would give you that same feeling? That's my whole argument on the thing. And I think that's just where the difference comes between you and me, why I like a game like Batman more than I like a game like Dishonored, like you.
My problem is that I can tell that like these situations were designed in such a way.
I get
and
that.
Also, it's just with Knight specifically. Again, I like City, but I think Knight specifically is just so keyed up to have these specific, like they want you to do these very specific things at specific times. They make it abundantly clear. And that doesn't make me feel like Batman, that just makes me feel like I'm playing some action game I have no control over.
I mean,
I don't know.
Knight has its own issues, you know, outside of that as well.
Yeah, I don't like that game. I beat it just to say that I did because I paid for it.
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, I just never bothered to pick it up. I was like, whatever. You know?
You're a good man.
Yeah. I mean, City failed. City was good, but it didn't leave the same impression on me that Asylum did.
No, and, exactly.
Yeah, same.
Asylum is just such a good condensed plot.
It's fucking amazing.
And design. It's like the design changed because they were like, we have to get bigger, but they didn't ever like change the core mechanics past that.
Yeah, very true.
You know.
Yeah.
So.
It was a quantity over quality thing, I think. With
For sure. I have a thing, I don't know if you want to call it a series. I guess it's a series.
Lay it on.
I've never been able to get into Final Fantasy Tactics, no matter how much I try.
Do you like other tactics?
And I like other tactics games.
That's interesting.
Like, I love Advance Wars, and I love...
You can
just,
also... You can name individual
right now,
games.
But...
I mean, I started this off by saying Final Fantasy VII, so, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, just like...
Which really hurts, Dave. I just want to let you know.
Yeah, I do love me some Final Fantasy VII, but I mean, I don't know what it is about Final Fantasy Tactics. It's just like, and by all accounts, I should love it. Like, I was the weirdo who liked Phantasy Star Online Episode 3, so by all accounts, I should love Final Fantasy Tactics. But
yeah,
like, do you like Tactics Ogre and shit like that?
I've never played Tactics Ogre, but I've heard of it.
Okay.
I've been wanting to give it a shot.
Because I think Advanced Wars is a very, very different, you know, so much more accessible than Final Fantasy Tactics.
Right. Well, that's why I like it. It's like kind of simple.
Yeah. And I'm not saying Tactics or FF Tactics is like hard by any extremes. It is, I think it gets difficult, obviously, but like,
right.
I think it's just there's a layer of that you need to break through in games like that, I think, which applies similarly to Tactics Ogre. And I can't think of any more off the top of my head, but maybe Valkyria, maybe, I don't know. But just games like that, at least to
Valkyrie
me.
Valkyrie for a second. I was like, isn't that a dog fighting game?
Or Valkyria Chronicles.
Valkyria Chronicles, that's yeah. the one.
I've never played that one either. I always mix it up with that Valkyrie Profile is what I always mix it up with. And those are very two different games.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, I just think you're not wrong. You know, it is a game that I think takes more patience. But I think there's like a moment where like maybe 2 hours into a playthrough of a game like that, it just like everything clicks in an instant. And then you are now invested in, okay, does the story click for me? Am I interested in the world and stuff like that? But
yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know about you guys, and this is kind of off topic, but I'm just curious. Like, I'm way more impatient about just getting into the core mechanics of a game now than I was when I was a kid. Like, when I was a kid, I was like able to be like, yeah, I like this weird kind of intro that they've constructed for me. And now I'm just like, can I please like start leveling up and like getting into the nuance and stuff? I don't want to sit through your 2 hour intro where you explain the world to
me. I feel
me.
Like you're specifically talking about the beginning of Kingdom Hearts 2.
Oh my god, that's such a bad
no
oh,
even as a fan I agree, like that whole thing is
shut the fuck up, Roxas. No one cares. But
it's like, oh, we're gonna go grind with our soap shoes and like
let's go get a job. Okay,
I don't know.
That sounds like a blast.
I kind of liked it, but am I the only one who liked it? I guess.
I guess you're the only one.
I guess.
I like Kingdom Hearts too.
It's more just like
two's a good game. It's just yeah, and then.
I think once you play it with knowledge of what the ending of that little intro is, it's actually kind of sad.
There's more emotion, I guess. Yeah. But still, like, it's boring.
Yeah. Well, it's just like Final Fantasy 13 is a great example. It takes you like 2 hours before they're like, you're now earning experience. It's like, why have I not been earning experience this whole time?
So like, much.
Yeah.
Because it also just leads up to there's a very slow realization in the game that like there's nothing else to it, and that's the most depressing thing for me.
Well, yeah. I'll loop this back actually, because we can actually tie this into the topic. Is there a game you couldn't get into because of that kind of like cruddily done intro? Like it just like the intro totally turned you off and you just walked away.
You know, when I was a kid, I'm the reverse from Josh. When I was a kid, I could not handle like just not getting a game instantaneously, so I played almost exclusively stupid games.
I'm just picturing Josh in I'm picturing Josh in a yellow and red uniform right now. I don't know. Some might say I'm reverse.
Wait,
you guys don't watch The Flash, do you?
No, I do not watch The Flash.
That's a Flash reference, but anyway,
well,
keep going.
I mean, I've read comic books, so
I know. But the line in The Flash show is like the big like meme line is like, some might say I'm the reverse.
God. Is that real?
Good job, CW. Is that real?
It's a good show anyway, Kyle, go on.
What was I even talking about?
I'm sorry.
On the okay, so yeah.
Intros there so bad that you didn't end up playing
yeah.
the game.
So yeah, like with Josh, that only happened when I was a kid. So I guess the only couple of times that did happen to me, I guess. Oh, I gotta think hard now. Fuck. I had it in my head, but shit, come back to me, I think.
All right, Josh, you got anything?
No, I like, man, there has to have been something recently that I played, but I can't really.
Yeah, because this
a lot of a lot of indie games, like I feel like I don't have time. You know what I mean? It's like if I jump in and you don't get me right to the point, I'm just like, no. I don't know.
Ace Combat.
Ace Combat.
Ace Combat.
Oh.
It took me years to get into Ace Combat, and I tried over and over again, and it finally. And so now I love that series. That's what it is. Because I played.
Okay, so it didn't turn you off. You just, you know.
Well, I mean, it did for like years. It's just like I would play Ace Combat 4, Shattered Skies, and like I love the fucking story because it's pretty anime-y. It's like in these fictional countries and stuff, and Grace Maria and shit like that.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I would play the intro, which would be interesting, and then it would fly into you going into this like air battle, and it would take so long to get to the air battle, and like because it's not sim, but it's as close as you can get without. You know, getting outside of the arcade barrier.
Without being a sim.
Yeah, essentially. Like, it's not Microsoft Flight Simulator, but it's not a Afterburner, right? So, like, you are taking maybe 5 minutes just flying in the air, waiting to get to the battle, and then, like, you turn and you yaw really slow and stuff like that. So I was just like, oh, this takes too long. I am 12 years old. You know, I should put my time towards other things. Yeah. And then maybe when I was 20, I got into Ace Combat because I sat down and was like, I want to give it one last shot because this game series is just so cool, right? Like, I like the idea of it. So I sat down with it. I actually played the same one, Ace Combat 4, which is my favorite one, ironically.
Yeah.
And it just hit. And I don't know. I've grown much more patient over time because when I sit down with a game, I am invested enough in the experience to be like, okay, I will wait for you to tell me what you've got. Of course, obviously, if I don't have the time for it, I will play a game that I'm more familiar with, right? I'll just jump into Halo or whatever. But if I jump, like, this is one of the reasons why I love Silver Case, right? I sat down with it. I played it until, like, I bashed my head against a fucking wall until I got it. And once I got it, it was like, this is amazing. I'm
not willing to do that.
Nope. I'm not saying people should be. I'm just saying, like, when I got it, I really enjoyed it.
My grandma... reads a lot, and she told me once that if she reads the first chapter and she is not into it, by the time she gets done with the first chapter, if she's like, this is boring, she just doesn't read it. And so I'm kind of like that though with games now, because like I just don't have all the time in the world, and I'm like, if I don't see where you're gonna be going with this, you know, I'm like, just, I want to, you know, if I'm playing an RPG, I want to be playing an RPG. I don't want to be sitting, like, I had to play that new Sword Art Online game recently.
Yeah.
Talk about a goddamn intro that made me want to kill myself. Ooh. Because it's like literally 45 minutes of all these anime characters talking, and I'm like, and they're all talking about how they can't wait to go out in this MMO world and fight stuff, and that's all I'm yelling at my screen.
Stop it, there, stuff!
All I want to do is just go fight stuff, and you're sitting here talking about cooking and like how cool the world looks based on the anime, and there's all these anime references. I'm like, I don't care.
Well, I mean, like, Josh, that game exists. I think that for is the anime fans. Like,
I realize that, you know. And I had no choice in the matter.
But... I think there's an interesting discussion to be had here, which. I don't want to delve into too much because that's going to drag us out way too long. But no. I think, like, this is how I know so many people that are like you, Josh. And, like, one of my very close friends was reading Gone Girl, which is, you know, a Gillian Flynn book got made into that David Fincher movie.
Yeah.
And it hinges on this, like, twist, right? But after the twist, even more stuff happens. So, like, when I was reading the book, I hated it, right? Because, like, the characters are so... just maddening, like you mm-hmm. just hate them, and that's sort of the point, but you don't realize that until like maybe a quarter of the way through the book, right? And so I think there is a level of like I with media in general, I really 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 love it when anything I'm watching, entertainment, music, when they push me and say, okay, you have to invest more than just your time to enjoy this. So like one of my favorite groups of all time musically, Clipping, they're experimental rap group. They have Davi Deegs, who's a great rapper, but outside of that, it's hard to really pitch it to anyone because the way that they do instrumentation is so experimental and innovative that, like, to a lot of people, it is just nails on a chalkboard. So, like, I'm listening to one song, which is they use an alarm clock as a beat because it's called Wake Up, and it's about like somebody who lives in the ghetto and has to like deal with a lot of the sort of PTSD that comes along with living there sometimes.
Yeah.
And so the alarm clock is the beat,
it's very grating for all my friends. But that alarm clock beat changes throughout the song and eventually turns into like this chorus backed up with this like choir. And it's amazing. And like, to experience that, you need to get through the song, right? So like, there are some games that I personally feel, I'm not saying Sword Art Online is one of them, you know, but there are some games definitely.
Based on the reviews, like, it's not.
Yeah, I think Sword Art Online is just a game for people that like Sword Art Online. But there are definitely games, I think, that exist where you need to break through a certain barrier to get to any part where you're understanding what they're trying to convey to you. And it's the same with movies. It's the same with books. And I don't disparage the fact that anybody personally would want to just, okay, get to the fucking pace. I'm jaded. I've gone through enough of these that I know when is it going to be good. And if it's not at this point yet, I'm out, because time is valuable. And I understand that. But for me,
yeah.
I sit down and I devote myself to whatever it is, because I want to, to me, I look at this stuff as an interaction between myself and whoever made it. And so I take that very personally. It's like an intimate thing with me. And I know I'm getting off topic here.
Yeah. But I think my biggest thing is like exposition in the very beginning of something like ruins it for me. It's like, if I want to discover more,
that's
I'll go
Star
discover
Wars.
It.
That is Star Wars. You know, like some Star Wars does that. There are some great things. Just
the
lay
movie?
Down some. Yeah, it starts.
Dude,
with
it starts
crawl.
With a ship flying in. And
yeah,
it starts with a text crawl. It starts with a very slow-moving text crawl.
Yeah, just,
sure.
Well, also,
okay.
And honestly, the whole first scene of
but
Star
the text
Wars, where
crawl isn't
where
like
the
30 minutes.
The rebel the rebel ship comes. This has been explained a bunch of times, but when the rebel ship comes across the screen, it's this little thing, and it's shooting back, and you see the big Star Destroyer come into view. That's actually like a microcosm of the entire war between the Rebellion and the Empire.
Also,
but,
there's payoff there, right?
Yeah.
Like, imagine that you don't know what Star Wars is, and you
Star
don't
Wars
know that the
cast.
Title crawl. But like, if you don't know what the Rebel title crawl is, radio. And this is the first time ever experiencing sci-fi, it's just like sitting down, and then they're like, okay, they're talking about some fucking rebellion and a princess, and like, who's the princess? I don't know. That's a really bad way to start off. Now, if you know that Star Wars obviously is inspired by the fucking the serials of the past that did stuff like that, then that makes sense. But, you know, there are like certain things like that that I think people, no matter what the medium, sort of have to overcome.
Yeah.
Sword Art Online in particular, like, I'm not saying that's one of them. I really want to make that clear.
Oh, Sword Art Online. I watched that anime.
It's not bad.
The first season. It was okay. But
yeah, I just
okay.
Like, I don't know. It's like,
it's no dot hack.
I don't want 30 minutes of exposition.
I mean, that's also JRPGs.
I don't think anyone really wants that. Not
anymore.
Just,
that's the genre.
I mean, I want the opposite of that. Like, you know, the what? Dragon Age Origins, where like you're literally the horde descends upon you in the first like 10 minutes of the game. You know?
But I mean, think about Persona 4, you know, amazing game. Takes a little bit to get into.
Yeah, that's probably
that's
the
why
one
I didn't
glaring...
get into it.
I did.
Oh,
though.
There's one.
Damn. Okay, there we go. This
Persona
whole
4.
Discussion, it led to it. We did.
Yeah.
We unearthed it.
I don't hate Persona. I like the idea of Persona, but like after an hour of people just talking and not entering one combat scene, which is like the whole point of me getting into it, is like, I want a JRPG. I want to level up and have all these things, like just waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting. And I was like,
God.
Oh, I can't take it anymore.
I have to put you in front of a visual novel and we're both going to sit in the same.
Dude, I can't stand visual novels.
We're both going to sit in the same room and Josh, you're going to be like, hey, Dave, where's the game? And I'm going to be like, this is the game. Like Fairly Odd Parents.
I'm not
lying, man.
Novels.
There are some amazing visual novels out
Dude,
there. But besides just the jokey ones that exist now because it's sort of reinvented into this comedy sort of genre.
The only one I ever got into was Hotel Boyfriend, and that's because there were a bunch of us drinking a bunch and doing the voices of the characters. Yeah. That's the only reason I got into that one.
It's not
I
a bad
got
time.
Another one I'm not into.
But the reason why I mentioned that, though, is because I do enjoy visual novels to a degree. So that's why I was kind of able to tolerate the beginning of Persona 4. And also because the mystery of it kind of ramps up pretty quick as far as the story is considered. But like, Persona is like the one game where I will let that go, where I will say like, you know what, you've grabbed me somehow. I will sit down and I will enjoy this. And I'm going to feel the same way about Persona 5. So
did you play 3, by the way?
I tried 3. I just didn't have enough time to play it. I was into it, though. Okay. Like, I actually was into it. It's just like time was a thing.
Right. I think 3's intro is worse, honestly.
Oh, it's even worse.
It takes a lot longer to get into it. 3, yeah. Hopefully 5 is just more. I mean, we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. Yeah. I mean, it looks amazing so far. So, you know,
oh, God,
every time I watch a trailer, I'm like,
so fucking
like, literally, I actually make that noise. But
there's rumors of it getting delayed, by the way.
Oh, but, fuck.
Yeah.
God, anyway. Damn it. But
it's already out in Japan, though.
I know.
Localization. But they're, I think the marketing has picked up enough that I think it's pretty safe. Like they're introducing,
I think it's going to do pretty good, yeah.
Yeah, they're introducing the characters already. They're doing interviews with the voice actors. Like, yeah, this is probably a done deal, hopefully.
One would hope.
So, not to make an incredibly long story short, but do we have any last thoughts on games that we just were not able to get into that everyone else seemed to love?
I think we hit the nail on the head.
I'll take your silence as a no.
I mean, I don't think I can't think of any. I'm sure there's others, but
there are others, right, yeah. But I don't want to keep us here any longer. Okay, thank you guys so much for listening tonight. We are the Geek Tank. This is our Geek Tank podcast that we put out every single week. Like we said at the beginning of the podcast, if you like this, please hit that like button on YouTube or let us know on your podcasting service of choice that you like us, whether it's a review or a golden apple or some bullshit like that. We don't care. Please just tell us that you like us, because we need that to validate what we do here. Anyway,
kill myself. It's all on you, listener.
Only you can save Kyle Bradford. Anyway, we have been the Geek Tank. You have been awesome, and we will see you next week.